Please join me in asking God's blessing on the ministry of the word. Speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Your people need a word. We need to hear from you. But we need your anointing, God, of our ears to hear. We need your anointing of our lips to proclaim your truth and not our opinion. And we need, God, the anointing of our hearts so that we will be receptive to you and your voice and your direction. We know you love us, but help us, God, to have the grace of hearing, the courage of proclamation, and the diligence of discipleship. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to take a moment to welcome our live stream cyber worshipers who are joining us live here from Third Street Church of God. We're thankful for the technology, and the video presentation is also available after today, archived on our thirdstreet.org website. So we encourage you to let your friends and your social media networks know that Third Street is now online, and we are thankful to have the opportunity to present our worship and our preaching and our ministry in the cyber community. The lesson has been read from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, verses 14 through 30. I'm not going to repeat that. It's the parable of the talents, and our message today is on the general theme of advancing the kingdom, advancing the kingdom, the parable of the talents. This parable is found in the middle of Matthew 25, and it's commonly known as the parable of the talents or the parable of the three servants. A talent is, in this text, a huge amount of money. This is not a story about what you do with the special abilities that you have. That's how we use the word talent, which, if you were to look up the etymology or the origin of this word in the English language, you will find that the word talent actually comes from this text, from this story. Because there's a history of interpretation of this parable that rejects its intention to compare our readiness for the kingdom of God with our ability to exercise stewardship of God's money. In other words, even the dictionary definition says, oh, that story is not about money, it's about ability. It's about special gifts. Can you sing? Can you speak publicly? Can you dance? Do you have talent? And so talent is how it has gotten interpreted, and that interpretation has worked its way into our English language. But I want to suggest to you today that whatever you may say about your talent or somebody else's talent, this is a story about money and investment. Now, ability is mentioned in the story, in the parable, because ability is the basis for determining how much money is entrusted to each servant to invest. So the only talent, in the way we normally use that word, that is relevant in this parable is the talent of financial literacy, the talent of knowing what to do with money, how to manage money. Verse 15, unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability. That's the King James Version. So when the master gave out the money, his money, to his servants, he did take account of their ability, not their ability to sing or their ability to work with their hands or to sew or to their athletic ability, but their ability to know what to do with money. A talent was worth about 20 years of a day laborer's wage. 20 years of a day laborer's wage. So let's do the math. If we were to use today's average construction worker's pay, I looked that up. Average day labor. We think of a day laborer, think of a construction worker. All right, and what I found was the average day laborer's pay is $14.45 an hour, okay? So if you multiply that, and I know you government bureaucrats know this math real good, you just multiply by 2080 to get the hourly wage to get the yearly wage. So you multiply that by 2,080 hours per year, and you get $30,056. And then you multiply that, so that's $30,000 a year. Stay with me now. That's the day laborer's wage average. And then multiply that times 20 years, and that's $600,000, 601,120. So the first servant got 5 times. See, that's 600,000. That's 1 talent. 1 talent. 20 times an annual wage. So that's 1 talent. So the first servant got 5 times this amount. So the first servant got $3 million. You with me? 600,000 times 5, $3 million. The second got 2 times this amount, or $1.2 million. And the third servant got 1 talent. Let's round it off even figures, $600,000. So you add it all up, what the three of them got is $4.8 million. That's about the value of our property here at Third Street Church of God. Right? Am I right, Mr. Daniel? Yeah, the buildings, right. It's about what our property is worth. If you ever see our financial statement, you see the bottom line financial statement. So it just came out that way. This came out that way. The parable has 3 parts. And I want to focus on this just for a few minutes. The assignment, the action, and the accounting. The assignment, the action, and the accounting. Each servant had the same assignment. Each of the 3 servants was entrusted with the master's money. Now, the amounts differed according to the master's assessment of each servant's ability. But they all had the same assignment. The master says, I'm giving you my money, and I'm taking a trip. But when I come back, I want to see what you've done with my money. Entrusted. But they did not all take the same action. Servant number two, we don't know their names, so let's call them that, invested the money. And servant number three hid the money. Investment means that they put the master's money to work. They used the money to make money. That's what investments do. Investment means you put the money somewhere where that money is going to earn more money. That's what investment is. And investment is not an evil thing. It's not a bad thing. It's just what you do with money. And so they used it to make money. They didn't spend the money. They didn't steal the money. And they didn't give it away. They invested it. The story does not tell us what kinds of investments they made. But we do know that the return was impressive over what seems to have been a long period of time, whatever was the time it took for the master to return. Now, we don't know if the master returned in years or months. We just don't know. The Bible just says that the master stayed gone a long time and then came back. And it may be that they didn't know when the master was coming back. All we know is the master stayed a long time. So they all had their assignment, and they took different actions. Two of them invested the money. The other one dug a hole and hid the money. Then comes the accounting. The master returned and settled accounts with the three servants. How do you settle accounts? This is just a simple question. What did you do with my money? What did you do with my money? Verse 19. After a long time, the master returned from his trip and called them to give an account of how they had used his money. The servant to whom he had entrusted the 5 bags of silver or talents came forward with 5 more and said, "Master, you gave me 5 bags of silver to invest, and I have earned 5 more. I want you to see there, I'm using the New Living Translation, that you gave me, that when the servant is given the account, the servant says, "You gave me this money to invest, and that's what I did. And I earned the money back double." That's a good investment. That's a great investment. The servant who was entrusted with $3 million, remember we did that calculation, $3 million in current terms, earned $6 million. I had occasion to follow a property in uptown, property, a vacant lot, that is now, it used to be site of one of our churches. And the property was sold, and the developer bought the property up near the Walter Reed Army Medical Center, which is now closed, and they've moved out to Bethesda. But right across the street, on the other side of George Avenue, there's a block there. And so a developer bought the whole block from Fern Street to Elder Street, just one block, not the entire block, but the frontage on George Avenue. And they paid a total of $2.9 million for the whole property, and without building one brick on it, flipped it for $7 million in the space of about 3 years. So when you think of flip, you know that term flip, usually that means you at least put some paint on, did something. They did nothing but sold it for $7 million. And so the people who currently own it are now building apartments and townhouses and intending, I'm sure, to make their money back quickly. And so that's just an example. When we look at this, these figures might be kind of mind-boggling to us, but every day in the city of Washington, people are making investments like this. Real estate, land, property, etc. But let's get back to the Bible. $6 million. The servant who was entrusted with $1.2 million doubled his investment to $2.4 million. And the master commended them both for their faithful stewardship. Notice it wasn't, the master didn't say, oh, you are shrewd somebody. Or, oh, you have excelled in cracking the code of Wall Street. It was just, you've just been a faithful steward. You're not commending you for having this excellent financial knowledge or genius. Your faithful stewardship. Verse 21, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount. It don't sound like a small amount to us, does it? But see, in the kingdom perspective, it's a small amount. You've been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. Or I think the King James says, enter now into the joy of your Lord. So you enter into the joy of your Lord. It's like, we're going to have a party. We're going to celebrate because the master is happy, the servant is happy, and it's all good because you did what I asked you to do. What is the reward for faithful stewardship? The reward is more opportunities to invest and to celebrate. You were faithful in the small, so now I'll give you more. I'm always amazed by people who want to be given a lot of responsibility and they haven't demonstrated in faithfulness in the little bit they already got. And sometimes that's how that prosperity gospel blows up on us. We're praying for increase, 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 and the Lord looking to say, well, what have you done with what I gave you? You want me to increase it? But you haven't done too much with the look. So you have to demonstrate your faithfulness with what you have. And then you show that you're ready for more opportunity. I wish the story ended here. It would be a happy parable, wouldn't it? If it ended right there. In fact, I would say that these are words that every Christian desires to hear said about us one day. Hopefully before your funeral. So that you can actually hear it. Well done. I mean, it makes for a good eulogy. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. We all want to hear that. We all want to be commended for being faithful servants. Those are great words. We read these words as the heavenly reward for faithfulness and service in the kingdom of God, as we should. But let's not overlook the fact that Jesus is telling a story about wealth and financial accountability in the kingdom of God. Each of us is entrusted with money in some amount. However that money comes to us, whether we earn it by working, by investing, by inheritance, whether we get a government check, or whether somebody just gives us money. We all get money from somewhere. We all, without exception, we all get some money from somewhere. And so this accountability is not limited to the millionaire. The servants who made millions were accountable for what they did with the master's money. But the servant who was entrusted with the $600,000 dug a hole and hid it, but he was also held accountable. His failure to invest the money was based on fear. Verse 25, this is what, he was as accountable as the rest of them. I was afraid I would lose your money, so I hid it in the earth. Look. Here's your money back. You almost get the idea. You ought to be glad I'm giving you your money back. I didn't steal it. I didn't spend it. I didn't lose it. Here's your money back. You can almost feel a little, take your money back. You almost get that attitude from this servant. But the master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant. If you knew that I harvested crops I didn't plant." That's what he said. That's what he said about the master. "If you knew I harvested crops I didn't plant and gathered crops I didn't cultivate, why didn't you deposit my money in the bank? At least I could have gotten some interest on it." Does that say that in your Bible, verse 27? That I could have gotten some interest if you had put my money in the bank. That's why I'm telling you, this parable is about money. Because it's talking about banking. And this wicked and lazy servant didn't even have the presence of mind to put the money in the bank. The master called the first two servants good and faithful. He used the exact opposite words for servant number three: wicked and lazy. He was wicked, not because of his ignorance, but because he falsely accused the master of being mean and unfair. Get that clear. He's not wicked because he was ignorant. He wasn't wicked because he didn't know what to do with money. He was wicked because he falsely accused the master of being unfair. See, when the one bag, servant number three with the one bag came, verse 24, "Master, I knew you were a harsh man, harvesting crops you didn't plant, gathering crops you didn't cultivate." He's making an accusation against the master. And there was no such accusation or statement that the other servants made. "Oh, we were scared of you, what you were going to do. Your expectations were too high of us." No, he's wicked because he made a false accusation. And he called the master mean and unfair. Because that's mean if you harvest crops that you didn't plant. That's mean. That's unfair. But that was his accusation. That's why he's called wicked. And he's lazy because he was too lazy to set up a bank account. If the banks then were anything like the banks now, since we did the math with the wages, let's see what we'll do with the bank interest. He could have set up a certificate of deposit or money market savings account paying maybe 0.03%. I don't know about your bank, but I know that's about what you get. Certificate, I mean, not 3%, 0.03%. And so he was entrusted with $600,000. So if he had put that money in bank of whatever, he would have earned $180 in a year's time. $600,000 investment, he would have earned $180. But that $180 is better than the interest rate in the unbanked hole. Because in the hole, the interest rate is zero. The hole has neither interest nor FDIC insurance. Now, see, that's one thing the bank will tell you, you got FDIC insurance. So at least you won't lose money. But the hole doesn't even have FDIC. Some people are afraid to invest because of the risk involved. And investment requires trust. You know, you're not going to invest. You're not going to invest in your church if you don't trust. You don't trust, "Oh, I don't know what they're going to do with the money. I ain't going to give them any money. I'm going to put my money in it." And it's a good thing to ask questions before you invest in anything, because there are plenty of people out here who will scam you, promise you the world, and try to scam you. They do it online. I had somebody on the phone the other day, rang my phone, and they were giving me this rant about the IRS, this and that, and people will say anything to try to get you to make a bad investment. So it's good to be prudent about not taking risks. But the hole, digging the hole, is not a risk-free investment. So the master was angry that servant number three was too lazy to put the money in the bank and at least earn a few dollars interest. The parable of the kingdom then. This parable has a sad and disturbing ending. The hidden money is given to servant number one to invest. And the unprofitable servant, that's what he's called, number three. The unprofitable servant is punished for hiding the money instead of investing the money. What is this parable teaching us then about the kingdom of God? It is a kingdom of the parable. It is a parable of the kingdom of God. It challenges us to recalibrate our kingdom assignments, our kingdom actions, and our kingdom accountability in light of the simple fact that the Lord has entrusted us with resources. The Lord has entrusted us with opportunities. And the Lord has entrusted us with the ability to make an impact in this world in his name. That's the kingdom. It's God's kingdom. God is in charge. And God has called us into his kingdom for such a time as this. And that calling that is upon us as the people of God is to recognize God has given us resources, God has given us opportunities, and God has given us ability to move forward in his name. The Lord has given us talent in the way that we like to understand that word, not the talent that's the $600,000, but talent in terms of the stuff you can do. The Lord has given us time, and the Lord has given us money and has charged us to become profitable stewards of kingdom investments. Money is not the only thing God has entrusted to us for kingdom investments. But money is necessary to support the ministry that spreads the message. And you know, here at Third Street, our mission statement, we have for many years had a mission statement. And the short version of our mission statement is that we are ambassadors for Christ in the nation's capital. And the theme verse of our mission statement, the mission statement is, we always have it. Try to keep it before you in your bulletin. It's on the front cover of your bulletin. But the basis of our mission statement is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19, that in Christ, God was reconciling the world unto himself, not counting their sins and trespasses against them, but entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. Paul uses the same word, entrust, in 2 Corinthians 5 as is used in Matthew 25. Entrust. God has entrusted us with a message for the world. And God has entrusted us with the resources to make ministry happen. So we have three things. We have a message, and the message is that because of the cross of Jesus Christ, there is forgiveness and there's peace with God and with one another. That's the message. The message is that there's no longer a barrier or a hindrance to us having, each of us having a relationship with God, and that God intends this for the whole world, not just for a select group of people, not for the rich people, not for the poor people, not for the black people, not for the white people, not for the men, not for the women, the world. This is a message, and because it's God's message, the message comes to us, and the message has its impact on us, but then we're supposed to spread the message. That's what ministry is. You are taking God's truth, sharing it with others. At the same time, you're doing ministry, and ministry is service. Remember, these people in this parable, they are all servants. That's their role. They are servants. That's who we are. We are servants. We serve God by serving people. We serve God by accepting our assignment, taking action on our assignment in a posture of accountability that we really believe the Lord is coming back. We really believe that we will have to answer for what we have done with the message, what we have done with ministry, and then God gives us the resources to spread the message, to sustain, because that's really what we're talking about here, sustainability, to sustain the ministry. God has given us resources, and among those resources are financial resources. God gives us the resource, entrusts the resources to us, and then God gives us the wisdom, the opportunity to invest for kingdom advancement. We are accountable to God for the message, for the ministry, and for the money. We are accountable to one another for the message, to stay on message. We have to keep reminding each other, let's stay on message, stay on message. Because there's no point in us having a message if the message is not doing us any good. We've got to preach the message to each other. We've got to practice the message among one another. We have to stay on message. We have to make sure that we stay focused on ministry. It's not self-service, but it's serving God. Serving God with an attentiveness to what it is that God wants us to achieve in this world. God wants us to spread the message that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. It's that simple. But Jesus had to go to the cross to make that message real. And our ministry first is to get ourselves reconciled to God. And then once we are reconciled to God, recognize that God has that blessing for every other person in the world, and not just the people you like, or the people who sing the same songs you sing, or the people who know the same people you know, but it's for the world, a message and a ministry. And so God's money is supposed to be spent on God's ministry, on God's message. The message gives meaning to ministry, and money provides the means for ministry. Did you know that it's kind of hard to do ministry in the absence of money? Somebody got to pay Pepco to keep the lights on. Somebody has to pay for the people to keep the carpet and the pews clean, keep the restrooms, keep the building in a condition where we can use it. Ministry requires money. And so sometimes we exempt ourselves and I think, well, this is money, now it's free. We don't sell tickets for people to come to church, although there are houses of worship where that occurs. But we don't sell tickets. We don't sell tickets. But we have to find some way to sustain ministry. And God's way is to entrust to the believers the money and the expertise to make the kinds of investments that will make ministry sustainable. So let's make sure that we put our money where our message is. Put our money where our message is. Let's be those good. Don't wait till you die to think of yourself as a good and faithful servant. But where you are, take an assessment. This is a good time to recalibrate. Lord, I want to be a good and faithful servant. So show me, God, how to make the best use of the financial resources you have entrusted to me. Not just what you give to the church, but just in general. God, I want to be a good and faithful servant. God gives us money so that, you know, but the Bible tells us, Jesus tells us so many times, Jesus says that God will take care of you. God will meet our financial need. God doesn't want us to be starving and naked and poor. God will provide for us. But when we have a surplus, that is over and above our basic needs being met, what then do we think about? Some of us can't conceive of the idea of surplus. So if there's extra money, we just got to spend it. Because it's just burn a hole in our pocket. And even if we think money is coming, like our income tax return or whatever, we already got planned how we're going to, because we just can't stand the idea of having extra money lying around. We need to adjust our mentality and our approach, because if we're going to learn how to make kingdom investments, we have to recognize that God gives us surplus for God's purpose. I'm saying when you make a sacrificial gift, that doesn't mean that you can't pay your bills and you can't. I know there's some pastors who disagree with this vehemently. They say you should pay your tithes before you pay your bills. I don't believe that. I believe you ought to pay your bills. Because if you get a bad credit score and stay in debt, that is a poor witness to the world of what kind of Christian you are. So I believe you ought to pay your bills. But you ought to pray that God will give you the wisdom to manage your money so that your bills can be paid and so that you can also participate and what God is doing with the message and the ministry. Good and faithful servants, profitable stewards of kingdom investment and advance. The message is too important for us to miss out on the means to make it effective. And we can recite our mission statement, and we can congratulate each other as ambassadors for Christ. But in order to be effective with the message, we're going to have to ask the Lord to show us how we at Third Street Church of God can sustain this ministry and this message to the glory of God so that people will drive by, walk by, walk in, and say, these people are blessed by God. Not impressed by the cars on the parking lot. I can take you to some churches. In fact, I don't have to take you to the parking lot. I just have to take you to the pastor's parking space. I could take you to churches. I could take you on a tour, because I've been to a lot of them, where you would be very impressed with the vehicles on the parking lot. But that does not necessarily translate into kingdom investment and advancement. Some of you are aware that Mr. Daniels is teaching a class, and he was at Howard University, and he was just sharing with me that he's expecting a guest in his class this week, who is Dr. DeForest Sorries, who is a pastor in New Jersey. I've known him for a number of years, but just a quick story, and I'll end with this, and we'll move to the communion. He has created this program called D-Free, where it's a program to help people get out of debt, especially Christians. And he started at his church in New Jersey because they had built this building, and the officers had come and said, well, Pastor, we're not meeting our obligations. You got to do something. We're not making it financially. And he said that he walked across the church parking lot one day. He's walking into the church, and he looked around and he saw the vehicles. And then it occurred to him, the people are not giving because they spend all their money on expensive cars. And you can read about this in his book. There was a Maserati on the parking lot. Some of y'all don't even know what that is. Let's just say, if you had a talent, maybe you could afford one. He's talking about that $600,000. Maybe you could get a Maserati for $600,000. And they had, you know, all the other cars. I won't name them because I don't want to talk about anybody's car. But spending a lot of money. And then he realized that people are in debt. That's why they're not giving. So he started this program. Now, he didn't have poor people in his church, but he had people who spent more money, spent above their means in his church. And so he started working on this debt reduction, and when he started working on that, everything came back into order. And he has created he has a book and a website and tremendous ministry. And so I have been very pleased. I've even preached at his church, and I've heard him. He's a very great speaker. And there was a Soul Dad O'Brien did a piece, a documentary on his church that gave profile some of his members. But here's the point. The kingdom is a kingdom of solvency. The Lord does not want us to stay in debt individually or as a church. And so we need to be open to how God will lead us from debt to solvency, from debt to the place where we will have every resource we need to do what we're supposed to be doing, which is ministry and the message. This is not a message designed to browbeat you into giving money. Because I say all the time, if you don't want to give it, please don't. Please never give money because you felt like somebody forced you or shamed you or no, you give because God has moved in your heart and God has given you the desire to give, and you see that your gift will establish your accountability for what God has entrusted for us. We want to be profitable stewards of kingdom investment and advance so that we can put our money where our message is. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your word. It challenges us. It stirs us. It excites us. But it also causes us to reflect on the great price that was paid for our redemption, our reconciliation. Thank you for the message you have entrusted to us. And in a moment, we're going to share at the Lord's table, remembering the sacrifice, the bread and the cup that we share will help us know that you spared no expense in making it possible for us to be forgiven, to be saved, and to have eternal life with you. And it's not just your desire for us in this church, but God, this is an invitation you've given to us to send to the world, to invite everyone, anyone, to be reconciled to God through the cross of Jesus Christ. And we pray, God, that you will give us the wisdom, the ability, and the desire and the opportunity here at Third Street to be open to the leading of your Spirit as you take us to the place, God, where you will equip us and entrust us with everything we need to make this message come alive, to make our ministry have its maximum impact in our neighborhood, in our city, and in our world. Use us, we pray. Help us, Lord, to be those good and faithful servants. Show us, God, how to trust you in the area of our finances. And God, we pray that you will help us to learn obedience and discipline when it comes to our monetary decisions so that we will learn how to honor you with our substance That we will honor you with our wealth. That we will honor you with our financial decisions. And that above all, God, we as a church and as individuals will have a positive witness. So that we don't have to put the phone on hold when the bill collector calls. That we don't throw the mail in the trash when the pink shows up in the window on the letter. But God, help us to be good witnesses in everything we do so that we will bring honor to your name and so that we will fully participate in the advancement of your kingdom. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.